Hello, everyone. This is the 8-week outline of the course. And even though I've taught this course before, I always reserve the right to change something. It's not likely I'm going to change anything in the Old Testament survey and New Testament survey because we're basing it on Scripture and what's in there. But we will do an introduction today to New Testament survey, and I'm going to spend quite a bit of time talking about the history of the Middle East, the Middle Eastern region, you know, the Levant, as it's sometimes called, the Western Mediterranean region, and all of the things that led up to the Jewish people, and then how that affected the way the Jewish people were during the time of Jesus, and how it affected the what we have as the New Testament today. So today we're going to talk about survey. Next week, what is a New Testament survey? Next week, the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Synoptic literally means same seeing. Optic is in there, right? To see. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are all three very similar in their approach. They took a very historical kind of approach. They talk about the events. Now, the events don't all line up exactly the same because that's not the way the Jewish people thought about things. Luke was not Jewish, but he interviewed Jewish people and got their feedback for it. Luke is the only writer of any book of the Bible that was not Jewish. He was a Gentile, and he wrote the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. Everybody else was Jewish. And so, but Matthew, Mark, and Luke take sort of a historical view with a Hebrew twist. They didn't think it was necessary to do things in a chronological order. Their focus was on grouping things together that they thought were relevant to one another, even if they're giving it a kind of a historical point of view, and even if they would take something that happened a year later and put it earlier because they thought, okay, people need to read about these things together because they were relevant to one another. So Matthew, Mark, and Luke take a Hebrew version of a historical approach to the story of Jesus. The Gospel of John, on the other hand, is more a theological book. It is less, while he tells the events of Jesus' life, he is less concerned with the historical details than he is with explaining what it means. And the Gospel of John was written much later than the others. The Apostle John lived much longer than any of the other apostles, the only one who died a natural death, as far as we know. And so he lived into his 90s. And my belief is that at that time he was living in Ephesus, along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, who they had sort of adopted each other after Jesus gave them to each other from the cross. And in Ephesus, John was kind of the senior statesman of the church, the last of the apostles who was alive. And I don't know if this is for a fact, but I get the sense that probably they came to John and said, look, we've got these other books, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, that had been written 50 years earlier almost, 40 to 50 years. And they said, so we know what the events were. Can you tell us more about what it means? Can you give us kind of an understanding behind what Jesus said and what he did? And so I believe that John, knowing that the other three gospels were already available to give the details, he focuses more on the theological aspect. There are long sermons and long speeches in the Gospel of John. We're studying the Gospel of John right now in our Bible study class. And there'll be a section where they're talking about events. You know, they went to this place, they did this thing. And then all of a sudden, John will go into sort of a theological reflection about the meaning of that. And then he'll come back and talk about, because he links those theological reflections to the events. But it's a very different kind of book. So the first three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are the synoptic or same-seeing Gospels. And then John is the Gospel that is much more theological. The book of Acts, which is the story of the birth of the church and the early growth of the church. We then will talk about Paul and the Pauline epistles, the great evangelist to the Gentiles. It was Paul that took the gospel, not solely, but he was the primary person who very intentionally took the gospel outside of the land of Palestine or Israel to Asia Minor, which what we know of today is Turkey, and we'll look at some maps as we talk about these various things that go along, and then later elsewhere. Now, there are already Christians in some of those places, because remember the first great sermon of the Christian church in Acts 2, when the Holy Spirit comes to them, Peter preaches this sermon, and there are thousands of people who respond to it. Well, those people were from all over. the book of Acts talks about the fact that they were all there for the Feast of the Passover, which the Passover was the recognition of when, for the Feast of the Pentateuch. Pentateuch was the celebration of the giving of the law for the Old Testament Jews. It's not just a Christian celebration. It was already a Hebrew festival. They were there for the festival of the Pentecost, and they had come from all over. They had come from Rome, and you know we have a description from Greece, from Persia, from North Africa. They had come there for this festival. Well, after Peter preaches, and there are thousands of converts, they go home. And so the gospel had been taken back. By the time Paul, for instance, he's writing the letter to Romans, he'd never been to Rome, but there were already Christians in Rome because it had been carried back there by the people who were converted in Jerusalem. All right? So we'll talk about Paul and the Pauline epistles. We'll break it up because there are 13 of them, Romans to Galatians, and because of length, Romans is the longest, and then the Pauline epistles too, from Ephesians to Philemon. Philemon is the shortest book. Then week 6 we'll talk about the general epistles, those not written by Paul, the book of Hebrews, and following up to Jude, and then the book of Revelation, expectations for fulfillment, and then conclusion. Okay? Questions about where we're going with that?
Are you going to have the PowerPoint presentation on a weekly basis like you did before?
Yes, just like this. Yeah. And this stuff is available online. I mean, in fact, this lecture is available online. I actually, in preparation for doing this again, I went back and watched it, and I bored myself.
Oh.
So I can't imagine. I did so much history last time I did this, which was in 2012. Then I'm not going to do quite as much history this time. I'm going to give a little bit more of the structure and form of the New Testament. But if you want to find out a lot of details about Alexander the Great and the Assyrians and the Babylonians and all of that, then you can go back and watch that video. I've lectured on those things elsewhere. So, okay? Now, this is a New Testament survey. I could have done the same description yesterday for Old Testament survey. So for those of you who are in both, this applies. What does it mean that it's a New Testament survey? Well, by definition, a survey course is an introduction and an overview. Our purpose here is to develop a clear view of the context and content of the New Testament. But it's from, as they say, from a 30,000-foot level. We are not going to dig deep into the meaning of the book of Galatians. This, again, by nature, in eight weeks, we are going to skim across the surface. And so that the goal, I'll talk about the goal in a second, to give you not details, not deep theological issues, but a basic understanding of all of what the story is. So what should you have a right to expect by the time you finish this course? You will, assuming that you attend all the lectures and you read the materials, you should have a very good sense of the historical and cultural context in which the New Testament was written, and a comprehensive understanding of what is in the New Testament, what's contained in the writings, and why we believe it's God's Word for us. Again, the next two courses I'll probably teach, starting in January, will be Old Testament theology and New Testament theology. In those cases, we will dig into issues like soteriology, which is salvation, you know, in New Testament, salvation theology, or the various other aspects of theology which are communicated to us in Scripture, but that's the theology course, that's not the survey course. Here, our concern is what does it say, and then next time, the classes in theology will talk about what does it mean. It's sort of like the difference between Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the Synoptic Gospels, and John. One is what's there, and the other is what does it mean. So, we'll get into that some. You can't miss that some, besides, given my nature, I'm always ready to preach. So we're liable to get into that stuff. Any questions about that? About what this class is about or what you should expect from it? Okay, is that fair?
The historical part is very interesting, so it's fine a little online.
Right, and I'm going to do some of that today. I'm not going to be quite as overbearing with all the history. Okay, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I get into stories about Alexander the Great, you know. In fact, one of the reasons I think I did that a lot last time is that was right before the first cruise series of lectures I did on the cruise ship, and I did a talk about Alexander the Great, and I did talk about several of these things, so I've done all this research right before that, and so I'm pouring all these stories out on people, and I probably got a little more than I needed to for an introduction to New Testament survey. Okay. Those of you who were here yesterday saw this already. This is what we believe about the Bible. This is why we believe the Bible is God's Word. We believe it is revealed, meaning not just that somebody made this stuff up, but rather it came from God. God revealed it to us. Jeremiah says, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, said, write in a book all the words I have spoken to you." The words came from God. We believe that is true of both the Old Testament and the New Testament. It is a revelation from God. Related to that, secondly, we believe that Scripture is inspired, meaning that while God used human beings, that He inspired them with the messages that He desired. 2 Timothy says, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work, or woman of God. Now, I don't think I mentioned when we talked about this yesterday that the word God-breathed, of course, the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, or Tanakh, as you learned yesterday, is written primarily in Hebrew. Part of Daniel is written in Aramaic, which was the common tongue that the Jews had learned during the Babylonian exile. So, and Daniel was in Babylon when all this was happening. But Hebrew and a little bit of Aramaic in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, Greek is the language of the New Testament. And we'll talk about a little bit later. How is it that a bunch of Jewish guys wrote the New Testament, but they wrote it in Greek instead of in Hebrew? We'll discuss that. When we read, though, from Timothy, 2 Timothy, all Scripture is God-breathed, the Greek word for breath or wind is pneuma. That's where we get the word pneumonia. You know, you lose your breath. Pneuma is also the word for the Holy Spirit. One of Billy Graham's early books was called Blow, Wind of God, and he's talking about the Holy Spirit, because the pneuma, the wind or breath, is the same word for Holy Spirit. So when Paul in 2 Timothy says, Scripture is God-breathed, there is built into the words there the sense that it is the Holy Spirit who is inspiring it. All right? Third, we believe that it is authoritative. We don't get to just pick and choose, which is the greatest failing of Christian churches nowadays and Christian ministers. They decide what part they like or don't like. There was a minister in one of the local churches, and he would never preach from Paul because he didn't like Paul. Okay, you've just taken out half of the New Testament. I mentioned yesterday that I know some ministers will not preach from the Old Testament because they don't think the Old Testament is valid for us anymore. Well, that's a heresy, and I think they're going to have to answer for that someday. But all of it is authoritative for us. And just because we don't like it or we have some other idea doesn't mean we get to decide. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes, "For what I received I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures." He quotes that as the authority for this. "That he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Paul and then to the 12." I'm sorry, that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. Paul is writing this. So, according to the Scriptures, there is an authoritative source that we look to that trumps every other source. The revelation given in Scripture is the highest level of revelation. That if somebody thinks that God has spoken to them and told them, well, Jesus wasn't really God, he was just a really nice guy and a good teacher. No, because the authoritative source for our revelation is Scripture. And it is very clear about that, I believe. And then the fourth point about what we believe about God's Word is that it is living. Again, you all heard this yesterday if you were in the Old Testament, or if you've taken the new members class, for that matter. For the Word of God, Hebrews 4, the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. And I asked yesterday, have you ever had a situation where you read a passage of Scripture that you've read maybe many times before, and all of a sudden it means something new to you? It applies to something that's going on in your life right then that you didn't pick up before because you didn't need it before. That, to me, is an understanding of what it means when it says the Word of God is living. That it is, by the power of the Holy Spirit, it applies itself to where we are and what we need at various times. It's not a static thing, so to speak. So this is what we believe about the Bible, which is God's Word.
Pastor?
Yes?
I don't understand the statement. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit.
Right. Well, I can.
I didn't.
I could get into a long discussion about the different theories of bipartite or tripartite, you know, human beings. Do we have a soul and a spirit, or is it the same thing? This is one of the verses that sometimes quoted as saying that human beings have a body, a soul, and a spirit, and that there's a difference between them. I actually tend to think of us as having tripartite, which means three parts, body, soul, and spirit. And the reason for that is, I have dogs. Do you all know that, right? Mm-hmm. Caroline and I have always had dogs, and we love those dogs. Dogs do not have souls in the sense that they're able to accept God and be redeemed and all of that sort of thing. But there is something more in them than there is in a tree. There is some aspect, there's something behind those brown eyes that our Malinois have that's more than just, you know, a tree or a rock or, you know, even a living thing, a tree, a plant, a, you know, stalk of corn. There is something else there, and yet they do not have a soul in the same way we do. I believe that there is an aspect of not full self-awareness, certainly not the ability to come to a saving relationship with a Savior, but there is something else there that makes them less than people, but more than maybe a chicken. I don't know. And that's how I differentiate them. Okay? And that may be completely wrong, but that's how I understand it. Because of the fact that we have several scriptures that do talk about soul and spirit, and then there are other places that talks about body and soul, keeping body and soul together kind of thing, then that's why there are different opinions about that. But this is one of the verses I believe communicates that there is a difference. And the Word of God is so incisive and insightful, it can get to that fine range. We can't even figure out where that dividing line is exactly. But the Word of God can, is what I think it's saying. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. And anybody that says that dogs are just dumb animals, I'll tell you who a dumb animal is. I'm sorry. Okay.
Well, the same can be said about people who don't eat chickens.
Ah, that's true. There are people with pet chickens. I'm not picking on chickens. There was a time in college, and I actually have thought about this again. You know, I did not become a complete vegetarian, but there's a part of me that's troubled by eating cows and deer and, you know, more than fish or chicken, right?
Anything that has eyes.
Well, I said anything that had prettier eyes than I did. So that was my definition for a while. Anyway, I'm getting off on that. So, we're talking about the Word of God, and particularly we're talking about the New Testament. So what is the New Testament? Well, the definition, according to Ross, is the New Testament is the story of the earthly life and ministry of Jesus Christ, which is found in the four Gospels, the birth and growth of the early church, which is the book of Acts, and the development and articulation of the Christian faith and theology, which is the epistles. And then I guess I could add, and a projection of how all this will come to conclusion, which is the book of Revelation. I've sort of included that in the epistles because it's part of the Christian theology. But it is the story of how this is all going to get wrapped up, basically. So that, to me, is an understanding of what the New Testament is. This is the definition of Ross, okay? Because this paragraph is my effort to try to say, how does this all hold together? What is this all? It is, again, the story of Jesus, the story of the early church, and the early defining and articulating of what Christian theology is all about. Make sense? Any questions about that? Is that clear? Okay, this will be something on your test. But then you'll know that because before you take the test, it will be on the what you need to know from New Testament survey. Okay? Now, when we talk about the New Testament, I've already gone over kind of the outline for what we're going to be studying. But the New Testament contains 27 books. All of those books are written in Greek and not scholarly Greek, not the Greek of ancient Greece, but rather Koine Greek. This is common Greek. This is a language that people would use every day on the street. In fact, early on, classical Greek, we have a lot of examples of. You know, we have Homer and the Greek philosophers and the, you know, Aristophanes, the various playwrights and things like that. We have a lot of examples of classical Greek. We had no examples early on of Koine Greek, other than the Bible, the New Testament. And it clearly is a different kind of Greek than classical Greek. In fact, up until the 19th century, there were some biblical scholars who referred to it as Holy Spirit Greek, because they thought that the Greek that was used in the New Testament was especially invented by the Holy Spirit and inspired in people in order to be able to write these books. Later on, as archaeology developed, they began to find more examples of common use Greek and discovered that this wasn't just something that the Holy Spirit had given to write the New Testament in, but rather was commonly used by the people of that day. And I'm going to talk about language in a little bit and why Greek is so important and how we got there. The books of the New Testament were written between roughly 40, or the mid-40s, and 100, or slightly before that, A.D., that is, Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. And I will say something else, too. If you're reading documents, scholarly books, you know, textbooks, whatever, they often now, you know, you're used to seeing, you know, 500 B.C. and 300 A.D. B.C. meant before Christ. A.D. means Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. It's in Latin, and so that's the dividing line when they decided that Jesus, even though they missed it by 4 to 6 years, okay, the first estimates were wrong. So 1 A.D. was not the first year of Jesus' life. But because of the fact that that time designation implies an approval of Christianity when some people aren't Christian, you know, they're Muslim, they're Jewish, they're whatever, there is a scholarly habit, a thing they do now, where instead of B.C. before Christ, they call it B.C.E., which means before the common era. So there's no reference to Christ in here. Okay. If you see that, don't panic, just knock the E off and you'll recognize it. All right. So B.C., before Christ, is exactly the same as B.C.E., which is the scholarly way of saying before the common era now, without recognizing Christianity as being the thing. They can't change the calendar anymore, not without panic. So they simply change the way they refer to it. All right?
So is AD common era? Is that what they would say?
Well, yes. Yeah, I'm sorry. That instead of AD, they will say CE, common era. So before common era and common era instead of BC and AD. All right? So it was written in that 60-year period or so, the scripture. Now, liberal scholars have suggested in the past that scripture was written much later, that Paul could not have written the things that are credited to Paul. They were written in the 300s or 400s AD, so 300 years after Paul. The more and more and more scholars, not just evangelical scholars, but more and more scholars, as they find more and more materials, are beginning to recognize and admit that the books were probably written early, as the traditional scholarly view was. And that is that all of what we have as the New Testament was written within 60 years of Jesus' death. And in fact, the last of the books written was written by, the book of Revelation was written by the Apostle John, who knew Jesus personally. He was only probably about 16 years old when Jesus was alive and when he was an apostle of Jesus. And he lived longer than all the others. As I said, he's the only one that died a natural death. But he was the writer of the last books in the New Testament, and more scholars are acknowledging the fact that these books were written earlier. That all the arguments for why they weren't written when tradition says, they don't really hold up. So we believe, from a traditional conservative point of view, that they were written in that time period. There are 9 different authors of the 27 books. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are the writers of the Gospel. Matthew and Mark each wrote one book each. Luke wrote 2 books, that is Luke and Acts. John, the Apostle John, wrote 5 books. And again, there's some controversy over that. Some people believe he didn't write Revelation, or he didn't write 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. You know, the tradition is he wrote the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and Revelation, 5 books. And I believe he did. In fact, I did a memorial service one time for Dave Netherton. And I mentioned, you know, the Apostle John wrote in Revelation, and somebody came up to me afterwards and said, "You really believe that the Apostle John wrote the book of Revelation?" I said, "Absolutely, I do." So people have that sense. Paul wrote 13 books. James wrote 1. This is James, the half-brother of Jesus. James, who was the head of the Jerusalem Council. He was the moderator, the chairperson for the Jerusalem Council. And we hear a lot about in Acts, for instance, there is the Council of Jerusalem meeting in Acts 15 when they decide Do Gentiles have to become Jews in order to be Christians? Do they have to be circumcised? Do they have to obey the dietary laws, etc.? And the decision of the council was no. Based upon the testimony, especially of Peter and Paul, they don't have to become Jews. And it was James, who is the head of the council, who issued the statement, the declaration as to how they were going to deal with that. So this is James, the half-brother of Jesus. Peter wrote two books, 1 and 2 Peter. Jude, and Jude is believed also to have been a half-brother of Jesus. In fact, his name was probably Judas, but after what happened with Judas Iscariot, that name sort of fell out of use, and people would use the name Jude instead of Judas. It's like, you know, how many people would have kids that they named Adolf, right? Unless they have a particular political bent that's not very popular. And then there is the anonymous author of the book of Hebrews. Now, many years ago, they believed that Hebrews was written by Paul. And that's why Hebrews comes right after the last of the Pauline letters. It was sort of thought to be the 14th Pauline letter. But scholars are universal in their recognition now that Paul almost certainly did not write the book of Hebrews. The style is completely different. The vocabulary is completely different. And that's not to make less of Hebrews. It's not saying that it's not shouldn't be part of Scripture, because clearly it is, I believe, divinely inspired. And the fact that it's, by the very name, it's oriented entirely toward the Jewish people, whereas Paul saw himself more as the apostle to the Gentiles. It is Paul who says that Peter is the apostle to the Jews, I'm the apostle to the Gentiles. That doesn't mean that Paul was not concerned about the Jews. He talks about them a lot. He would always visit the synagogue. In fact, he got so frustrated with the Jews at one point, he said, "I shake the dirt off my feet, I'll have nothing else to do with the Jewish people." Well, the next town he goes into, the first thing he does is he goes to the synagogue to give witness to the Jewish people. So he was concerned about them, but the book of Hebrews is entirely focused on the Jewish people in a way that's not consistent with the rest of Paul. We don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. It is unique in that there is no accreditation given to it. I myself and Carolyn's mother, when she was alive.
The theologian.
Her mother, the theologian. And our old pastor, Earl Palmer, in Seattle, I didn't know this at first, and we found this out on a cruise we were on with him, believe it may have been written by Priscilla. Priscilla and Aquila. There are various people. Some people say maybe Barnabas. Some people say maybe Apollo, who was from Alexandria, who was taught by Priscilla and Aquila. But the mystery is, knowing the authorship of one of the, was a requirement for them to consider a book as being part of the New Testament canon. The only and it would had to either be written by an apostle or someone who had been a student of an apostle. The Gospels, Matthew and John are apostles. Mark was John Mark that had traveled with Paul, and then later on he became a secretary and assistant to Peter. And so the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, is pretty much the Gospel according to Peter, because Mark is sharing what he learned from Peter about the life of Jesus. And Luke, of course, was a follower and assistant to Paul. And when Paul was in prison for 2 years in Caesarea, that's when Luke goes around and he interviews everybody, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, to get the information about, to put in. And he says, "My goal here is to provide an orderly accounting of this story, O Theophilus." He writes it as a dedication to someone. That's why it's in Luke that you hear that when Mary is visited by the angel and tells her she's going, it says, "And Mary treasured all these things in her heart." Well, how do you know that? Because she told him that was what was happening. And the Gospel of Luke is because Luke interviewed all these people in preparing that gospel during the 2 years that Paul, who he had been working with, was imprisoned in Caesarea. But why is Hebrews the only book that we don't know the author of? It's not an apostle. It's not somebody approved by an apostle. And yet it's, and there had been questions. There have been a few times early on when people said maybe it shouldn't be in there. But it finally was accepted because it clearly is divinely inspired. It clearly is canon. It is the Word of God to us. Well, probably the best explanation I can come up with, and others as well, as to why they would accept it as being godly, you know, God's Word to us, but not identify the author, is if the author for some reason might have been unacceptable, like a woman at that time in history. Okay, that for a woman to have written a book that was being considered part of the New Testament would probably have created a big fervor. So better just leave off the part that it was written by a woman and accept it for its own content. It's the only book that's the case. which is why I think it might have been written by Priscilla, who clearly is very, was a great theologian, because she and her husband Aquila or Aquila were, they worked with Paul, they were tent makers together, they studied together, and then they were the ones that trained Apollo, who became a great teacher in the church. When it first starts, they refer to Aquila and Priscilla. And after a very short time, they turn it around and start calling them Priscilla and Aquila or Aquila. That was very rare. You never named the wife first in that culture and in that time. There was something very special about her. Okay? About the whole couple, but that gives you kind of an idea. See, I can go off on tangents and all kinds of stuff, but so this is what we mean by the New Testament. And here's a way of looking at it kind of structured. Sure.
You said there are or were some people who thought that the Pauline letters were written 300 or 400 years later. What did they base that on? Because the first thing I thought of was, to write those letters, you would have to know a lot about Paul and his schedule and events and everything else. And then if you were writing something, why would you give credit to or blame it on someone else? So it must have, was there some reason why they did say this wasn't Paul writing it?
Well, some of it. Yesterday we talked about the in Old Testament survey, we talked about the documentary hypothesis, Wellhausen's hypothesis. The guys who proposed that, they started out with several assumptions, that Moses couldn't read or write, which has been disproven. They started out with the assumption there's no such thing as miracles, and so therefore, since the Old Testament talks about a lot of miraculous stuff, you can't really trust it. So if you start out with the presumption that this probably isn't true anyway, then you can come up with all kinds of theories.
Yeah.
And I think that's much of what we see. And because I think that's a lot of it in speaking. For instance, miracles. Paul's full of miracles. Paul's full of the expression of the gifts of the Holy Spirit in miraculous ways, and of people being raised from the dead. And of, you know, Paul, I could sympathize. Paul is preaching one night, and he preaches so long outside in the yard that people were sitting in the windows, and a young man that was in a third-story window, Paul preached so long he fell asleep and fell out and died. And then Paul raised him from the dead. So liberal scholars who, you know, preaching so long somebody falls asleep, can't imagine. But if you start out with the assumption that none of that stuff can be true,
you can go anywhere.
You can go anywhere.
Yeah. Okay.
And so as we get more, and frequently people who do that sort of thing will say, well, as we find more archaeological discoveries, this will all be proven that Paul didn't write this stuff. Well, the more we find, the more it is demonstrating that the traditional understandings of Scripture really are accurate and are true. How do they get there? These guys make a living by getting, you know, papers published and by getting a name for themselves. And who wants to publish an article about something that everybody already believes? Yeah. Got to come up with something different and weird. And that's part of it, I think. And I think the devil may have a little bit to do with it, too. I'm just going to stick all this up here so we can look it all up at once. So there are five basic sections, if you will, of the New Testament. The Gospels, and that's both the Synoptic Gospels, the first three, and the Gospel of John. The second, which is only one book, but it's a fairly long book. In fact, Luke wrote a significant portion between the Gospel of Luke, which is the longest Gospel, and the book of Acts, which is a fairly long book. He wrote, is it like 32% of the New Testament? I think it is. I think that's right. So the Acts of the Apostles, then the Pauline Epistles, Romans, 1 and 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, and Philemon. Now, these are not in chronological order. The order of these things makes sense when you realize first it tells the story of Jesus, the Gospels. Then it tells the story of the birth and early growth of the church, the Acts. Then we get the theology from Paul first, and then the general epistles, Hebrew, James, 1st, 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, John, and Jude. And then the consummation, how it's all going to come to an end, which is the book of Revelation. But within those categories, in the Pauline epistles, those are not in chronological order. Galatians was the first book that Paul wrote, and it falls, you know, a little bit short of being halfway through. Romans comes first because Romans is the longest. Philemon comes last because Philemon is the shortest. I don't know who thought that was a good idea. to put the letters of Paul in order of length. Now, it's also true that Romans is theologically the most significant book of all the epistles. I mean, it is the theological, you know, summa theologica, the summation of theology for the New Testament. And that's another reason to put it first. But to put them all in the exception of that, by the way, is 2 Thessalonians is attached to 1 Thessalonians, 2 Timothy is attached to 1 Timothy. But I'll talk in a few minutes about the order that these things actually occurred in. It's probable that the book of James was the first book written, either James or Galatians. And it's interesting that whichever one was written first, the other one may have been written as a complement to it. Because the book of James is faith without works is dead. The importance that we live out our life in very real ways, that we get changed by the gospel. Very consistent with Jesus, who said, if you love me, you'll obey my commands. But then the book of Galatians is written to the churches in Galatia against the Judaizers, or Ebionites, to use the technical word, those who said you had to be circumcised. If you're a Gentile, you had to be circumcised and live as a Jew in order to be a Christian. So it's the opposite to some people's mind. The book of Galatians is about legalism. Works is not part of the deal. It's what your faith is. So it's not that they're contradictory to one another at all. It's that they recognize the two halves of what it means to be a Christian. And James emphasizes that we have to live as Jesus told us to. If we mean it, we really mean it. Galatians is saying it's not anything you do in the physical body. It is what you where your heart is. Those two things complement one another. They're not conflicting, I don't believe. But those were the first two books. And whichever one came first, the other one may have been written as a balance. Not as contrary to, but as a balance to. Okay. And then the book of Revelation. Questions about that? Okay. You really can ask questions, by the way. I'm not that scary. I want to talk a little bit more about the New Testament. We'll take a break, and then I'm going to come back and do the onerous history part. The history stuff. The word testament, as in Old Testament or New Testament, testament is not a word we use a lot anymore, other than last will and testament. And testament actually means a covenant or an agreement. Covenant being something that two parties agree to, and that defines their relationship. Okay. The Old Testament or Old Covenant is about God through Abraham raising up a people, the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, to be his select and chosen people amongst all the world. And that through him, Abraham, and through them, the Jews, we often forget that God said to Abraham that one of the blessings is, through you I will bless all the peoples of the earth. The promises were, I will make of you a great nation. Even though you're an old man and your wife is an old woman, you're going to have kids and you're going to become a whole nation. Secondly, I will give you a land to call your own, the promised land. And the third promise to Abraham was, through you I will bless all the people of the earth. When Abraham's son Isaac, when God blessed him, God said through, he included all the same thing. He said, through you I will bless all the people of the earth. He said the same thing to Jacob. So the first covenant, or the old covenant, the Old Testament, was God's relationship with the Jewish people. But always there had been the promise that through the Jewish people, I will bless all the peoples of the earth. And then we get to the new covenant, which was established when the Son of God, Jesus Christ, became a human being and lived on the earth. That new covenant, that new agreement, if you will, is not a complete diversion from the first one. It's not like God said, well, this isn't working, I'm going to have to try something different. The coming of Jesus and the new covenant, the New Testament, as we would call it, which is what this part of the Bible is about, was the fulfillment of the promise that God had given all along, that through the Jewish people, he would bless all the people of the earth. Jesus was a Jew. All of his first followers were Jewish. All of the apostles, all of the first disciples, up until Cornelius the centurion and his family become Christians, and then the church in Antioch, where Paul and Barnabas were, they had Gentile believers as well. When that first started happening is when they had to have the Council of Jerusalem in Acts 15 to figure out, what do we do with these Gentiles? They're not Jews. Can they be Christians? Can they follow Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah? So Jesus was Jewish, all of the early followers were Jewish, all of the books except Luke and Acts are written by Jewish people in the whole Bible. It was a Jewish faith. And the continuity is simply a fulfillment of God's promise all along. It's not new in the sense that it is completely different from it. Jesus said, I didn't come to do away with the law, but to fulfill it. Right? It is new in the sense that it is renewed. There are new terms to fulfill the promises that were part of the first covenant. But the word new is a statement that God has opened it up to the rest of us. We are honorary Jews. We are, you know, and any anti-Semitic who claims to be a Christian is schizophrenic, as far as I'm concerned. Because Paul is very clear that the root stock of the people, chosen people of God, are the Jewish people, and that we are grafted on to that rootstock. We are honorary Jewish people, and that's why we have become part of the chosen people of God. Yes?
Can you define chosen?
That God specifically selected them above all, over all the other peoples of the earth to be His people.
Why?
We don't know. In fact, in theology, they refer to the scandal of exclusivity. Why did God not choose the Egyptians, one of the very oldest culture, probably the second oldest culture in history? Brilliant art, history, you know, why didn't he pick the Akkadians or the Hittites or the Assyrians or the Babylonians or one of these major powers? You know, think what he could have done if God had chosen a people that had an army that could defeat the world, or Alexander. Instead, he chose this one man first and one woman, Abram and Sarai, whose names later get changed to Abraham and Sarah, and promised that he will raise up a people through them, and even though they are, by any political sense, an insignificant group of nomadic herdsmen, up until the time of David, there was no political significance to them, and even then, only for two generations, David and Solomon. That's why they refer to it as the scandal of exclusivity, which basically means we don't know why God did that.
Was there some part that the chosen people were to go out and be spiritual to teach us about God and the relationship with Him?
There's never been a sense in the Jewish people of evangelism.
Right.
But weren't they supposed to be an example?
Right. They were to be a light to the world, yeah. An example of what it meant to be the people of God, yes. They didn't do a very good job of that a lot of the time. I mean, which is why people who say that the New Testament, speaking of Old Testament and New Testament, that the New Testament is the story of grace and of mercy and of God's love and of giving His Son, but the Old Testament is about law and judgment and, you know, punishment and all that. People who say that have not bothered to read the Old Testament. Because, yes, there is judgment and there is punishment in the Old Testament. What happens is God takes this people and puts His arm around them and said, you are my beloved people. You are my chosen ones. You are my family on earth. I will be your God and you will be my people. And what do? They immediately turn around and go off and sacrifice their children to Molech or worship the Baals or put up Asherah poles on top of the mountains. And God would condemn that, and He would judge them for that. There would be punishment of some kind, and then almost immediately, in most cases, God says, but you are still my beloved people. You are my family, and He gathers them back and loves them and blesses them, and they do it again. They turn their back on Him and go off and worship other gods. That happens over and over and over again, but every time the Israelites prove unfaithful, God proves faithful. He still takes them back and loves them. In fact, one of my favorite Old Testament books is the book of Hosea. The book of Hosea is a living example of what God was experiencing with the Hebrew people, because in Hosea, God tells the prophet Hosea to go and marry an unfaithful woman, basically a prostitute. Her name was Gomer. Bless you. And Hosea is obedient. He marries Gomer. And several times we hear Gomer runs off and is cavorting with other men. And one time she apparently gets herself in so much trouble, she's sold into slavery. And God tells Hosea, go get her. Go bring her back. And in one case, He has to actually buy her to bring her back. And they have several children. And the children are named, I've always said, they had to be, you know, need a lot of counseling as they grew up. Not loved was the translation of one of the children. Not my people was another one. This was literally, God had Hosea with Gomer and these kids demonstrate in a very real way what God was going through in trying to show his love for an unfaithful people.
But he's still the God of everyone.
He is, and he demonstrates that. In fact, again, we mentioned it yesterday, the Assyrians that destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel, this horrendous army, one of the most vicious ever. In fact, if you ever go to the British Museum, they have some of the relief carvings from some of the ancient cities of Assyria. And there are images there of captives in war being flayed alive, skinned alive. There are images of them piling up the heads of people outside the gates of cities that won't give up. They were a notorious bunch. And yet, the story of Jonah and the big fish, or Jonah and the whale, Jonah was told by God to go to Nineveh and to tell them about him. Nineveh was the capital city of Assyria. And he won't do it. And he turns and runs, right? He runs off to try to get as far away as possible, and then we have him, being swallowed by the fish and coughed up on land and, all of that. And then finally he says, I'll go, and he goes to Nineveh. The first time he preaches, the city converts to belief in Yahweh God. And it makes him mad. Jonah stomps his little feet and says, "Bleh! These are Ninevites, they're Assyrians. I don't want them to convert." And he just throws a hissy fit over it. God was concerned for the Ninevites. Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, the one who conquered the southern kingdom of Judah, converts to belief in the one true God. Right? The Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego event, the people who witnessed that, believed that their God was the one true God. So we have examples where other peoples, not Jewish people, recognized that this was the God of all, and God chose the Assyrians. He called the Assyrians to bring judgment on the northern kingdom. He called the Babylonians to bring judgment on the southern kingdom. He is the God of all peoples. But that's why it's a scandal, which basically means just there's no way to explain this. We can't understand why God would choose one man, one woman, and then eventually their offspring, a small nomadic tribe of people, to be of all peoples of the earth his special people. Okay? Yes?
About that, I've had trouble with that in the past at times, and for me, I finally settled it for myself that, and this isn't scriptural, God made creation. He didn't have to, he wasn't required to, he didn't need it. Evidently, he just chose to. It was his will. The garden, fabulous place, didn't have to, just did. Adam and Eve, and well, creation of everything, and then create man in his image. He chose, and then he chose the Jewish people.
Right.
And it's like, he's done a lot of choosing, it seems to me.
Yeah.
And we don't ever argue about any of these.
Yeah. And he's the only one who has a real right to choose, because it's all his.
Yes.
And we sometimes fail to realize that in the course of history, God has always maintained, kept his finger on things. We feel like sometimes things are out of control, but they come back around. I hear all the time people saying, "Boy, this is the worst time in history." And I'm going, "You don't know anything about history, do you?" when the barbarians kicked down the door, Alaric and the Goths kicked down the door of Rome, which was the center of Western Christianity, and sacked the city, they had a reason to believe that the world was ending. When Constantinople was finally taken by the Muslims after hundreds of years, people had a reason to believe that that the world was coming to an end. We got nothing compared to any of that. I mean, yeah, there are some things that are difficult, but it's nothing compared to what the world, and what particularly people of the faith, have had to go through over the millennia. Okay, so yeah, it's and God has a right to choose whatever he wants. And you remember Hannibal and the elephants crossing the Alps and fighting the Romans? Actually, he never had to fight the Romans because he's marching up and down the Italian peninsula wanting to fight the Romans, and they kept running away from it. The only reason that Hannibal won was because the Romans refused to actually fight it. And finally, there was trouble at home back in Carthage, and he had to load up and go back to Carthage. Well, if Hannibal had won and the Romans had lost, the Carthaginians practiced child sacrifice. They worshipped gods that demanded horrendous things. If Hannibal had actually come to grips to be able to fight the Roman army and had won, then they would have become the dominant power in the central and western Mediterranean. They would have been the one that set the terms for the future. And while we may not think all that great a thing about the Roman deities, they didn't involve child sacrifice. You know, they did involve some other unpleasant things, like leaving children who were deformed out, you know, into the elements. But that's not quite the same thing as taking your living children and putting them in a fire, because their screams were considered a blessing to the god Molech. Okay? God's never taken his finger off this stuff, and he still won't. Even the first Christian martyr, before he's stoned to death, all of those things looked at the story of the Old Testament, the story of the Jewish people, as evidence that pointed directly to Jesus as the Messiah. Most of you know that I work with Messianic Jewish organizations as a consultant. I have a new one. I'm working with Jewish Voice Ministries now. I've worked with Jews for Jesus. Prior to that, I worked for Chosen People Ministry. It's not that I particularly pick out Messianic Christian organizations, but that's just how it's worked out. And in every case, their Christian witness to fellow Jewish people has to do with looking at the Old Testament and using that as the clear evidence that Jesus is the fulfillment of that expectation. So through the Jewish people, and even through their disobedience, and through the judgment that God had to bring, and through the captivities that they experienced in Babylon and under the oppression of the Romans, all of that was in preparation for the great redemption. It made it very clear that the people were not sufficient on their own, and that they needed God to intercede for them in some redemptive and atoning way. And so the very nature of the relationship of the Jewish people with God was a preparation for the coming of Jesus, and therefore the witness of the New Testament. It's also true, and I don't think we take this enough into account. Earlier I said, you know, why is the New Testament written in Greek when the people, all except for Luke, all of them were Jewish? And Greek is not the first language of the Jews. Well, the reason very simply is because in the 4th century, early in the 4th century, Alexander the Great, the dude, as I like to call him, rose up from Macedonia, part of what we know of as Greece, and I'm going to talk about him a little bit more in a few minutes, and he conquered pretty much the whole known world. And then he died at age 32, 33, right there. And in the process, everywhere he went, he planted Greek culture, because he loved Greek culture. He thought of himself as a son of Zeus, reincarnation of Achilles, and he never lost a battle. And sometimes he would take a 30,000-man army and fight a 200,000-man army and win. He never lost. And so he spread the Greek culture. And at first it was required. It was imposed because he was the conqueror. Later on, people liked it. Greek is a very efficient kind of language, Greek and Latin both for that matter. And so Greek culture, Greek history, the Greek mythologies, Greek language became very dominant. What that meant was that it became the international language. Even after the Romans conquered the whole Mediterranean basin, they referred to the Mediterranean Sea as being the Roman lake at one point, because they controlled everything around it. They spoke Latin as their natural language, but all of them still wrote Greek. Marcus Aurelius, one of the emperors, when he wrote his histories, he wrote them in Greek. When Paul is writing to the church in Rome, he wrote the letter in Greek, because everybody read Greek because of the influence 350 plus years before that of Alexander the Great. Now what that meant was, if you had to set up a situation where, and every country had its own language, even Macedonia had its own language, but they preferred Greek, Alexander did. If you were trying to write or travel to and share a message with people, how difficult would that be today if you went to the various countries in Europe for the first time and you wanted to tell them about Jesus? How many languages would you have to speak? All right? For five. Okay, well, most people would speak one of five languages because, you know, they're closer together and they tend to speak more languages. But countries have different languages. Hungarian is a unique one, similar to Finnish. Nothing else is anywhere near close to those. Portuguese, Spanish, Italian, French, German, Greek, you know, all of that. Well, in the time of the New Testament, everybody spoke Greek. There was a common language, even more so than today. English is common throughout. It's the business language in the world. Every pilot of every international airline has to be able to speak English, because all air traffic control communication is done in English, for instance. But in those days, everybody spoke Greek. That meant you could communicate with everybody. And the spreading of the gospel of Jesus Christ happened significantly because everybody could understand the same language. They could write a letter in Greek and everybody could read it. There has never been quite the same kind of situation at any other time in the world than in the first century AD. Yes?
I think you told us last time that another reason for Greek was that up and around the sea, all the trading that went on was in Greek, done in Greek, because they could buy and sell and trade, and that was also a real motivator for being able to speak Greek.
But that was especially after Alexander. You know, it became the dominant language in everything. It became the commercial language. It became the language the militaries would use. It became, you know, everybody spoke Greek, whatever else they might speak. And that's kind of hard for us to picture today. But Koine Greek, common Greek, everybody spoke it. And that was critically important. It's also true that the Roman Empire, despite the fact that later on the Romans were responsible for some pretty horrendous persecution of the Christian faith, when Rome had conquered and Pompey in the first century BC, between 63 and 6 BC, he came down and conquered the Middle East, the area we know as the Holy Land, Palestine. And when he did that, the extent of control of the Roman Empire covered all of the Middle East, and you know they continued to sweep on through North Africa and everything else. Well, two things happened because of that. One, they built roads. Everywhere the Romans went, they built roads. If you've been in Europe, you may have seen some of those roads still exist. Now, they're not like paved asphalt roads, but they're flagstone blocks that you could run wagons on, and they would cut these through mountains, you know, over tops of mountains, but they created a way that you could travel from place to place knowing that you weren't going to get bogged down in the wilderness and that there were going to be way stations periodically that you could get something to eat and someplace to stay, you know. That was tremendously valuable as people tried to travel from place to place, and that had not existed before the Romans. And the other thing is, in addition to providing transport, the Romans introduced what was called the Pax Romana, or the Peace of Rome. One of the big deals for the Roman Empire was law and order. You know, when they conquered all these different places, they would allow them pretty much to rule themselves as long as they did two things. They paid their taxes, and they didn't riot, because law and order was a big deal. If there was a problem in terms of lack of law and order or riots or criminal activity, the Roman army would come in and step on people's necks until it was straightened out, and they would do so ruthlessly. Well, because of the Pax Romana, that meant you could travel the roads between the Middle East and Asia Minor and even into Europe without fear of bandits, or pretty much without any fear of bandits compared to what it had been prior to that. You could take sea voyages without fear that pirates were going to take your ship, because the Romans wouldn't allow that. Pirate trying to take over ships in Roman-controlled waters wouldn't last very long. So the Romans, Pax Romana, the roads that they provided, all of that, plus the Greek language, were major factors in why it is that Christianity was able to flourish in the way it did. We believe all of that is part of God's timing, you know, that God intended that. Another aspect was the nature of the religious beliefs in that time period. They were the only monotheistic religion that had existed was Judaism. And yet, the old religions, the pagan religions of the Greeks and the Romans, you know, the pantheons of belief in gods, was really old and tired. And those religions there's no sense of salvation, there's no sense of redemption, there's no sense of being able to be in a relationship with the gods. In fact, the Greek gods were notorious for doing mean things to human beings just to see how they acted. It's like, you know, putting ants on a hot griddle to watch them dance. That's sort of how the Greek gods treated them. It wasn't a very friendly kind of religion. Because of that, there are other religions that had grown up that tended to be more, give you more an opportunity to be in relationship with deities. Like Mithraism came out of Persia. It became the favorite religion of military. And it was the god Mithra, who was a military god. But you could be part of a cult, a group, and have the union with other people, and that the belief that Mithra would make appearances. The Sabelli cult and other Oriental, as they were called then, cults, the mystery religions they were referred to, because they promised some greater interaction and relationship with deities than any of the Romans and Greek religions. But there was a deep desire for having a religion that would give you more satisfaction. The only monotheistic religion that existed was Judaism. And in fact, a lot of the people in that day were attracted to Judaism in terms of its belief in one God. There's a reference in scripture, and historically a lot of reference, to what were called God-fearing Gentiles. Cornelius, the first Christian, Cornelius and his family, who were first Christians, he's called a God-fearing Gentile. He had supported the Jewish synagogues and whatnot. What that meant is, they really liked the idea of one God, but they were unwilling to become Jews. Why? Because if you're a man and you wanted to become a Jew, it involved a very kind of radical change in your anatomy. Circumcision. And especially to people coming out of a Greek culture that really almost deified the human form, you know, all the Greek sculptures and everything, the idea of doing something to cut off part of your body in order to join a religion was not well thought of. And so even though, and it's almost as though these God-fearing Gentiles would go and stand outside the synagogue to try to listen, but they couldn't actually become a member. Well, along comes a belief in the same God, but now Gentiles are allowed to join without having to go through circumcision, without having to give up bacon and shellfish and that kind of stuff. And there was a raft of Gentile people who were anxious for this to come along so that they could become part of this belief in one God, because the pantheons of the other religions simply were not satisfying to them. So there was an aspect of that as well.
It sounded like really that it cannot be called, what is the historical
date?
Yes.
The date of what?
When Alexander conquered the world.
Yeah, it was in the early 4th century BC. So the 360s in there, sort of mid 4th century. And you all know, of course, that 4th century is the 300s. 1st century is the zeros, right? Okay, because the 1st century is from 0 to 99.9. I'll leave that alone. Well, I want to now, are there any questions about any of that? Yes, Laura.
Just going back to the chosen people, after they had been conquered in Israel and they had been introduced to blended marriages and things like that, I mean, mm-hmm. today we come down to probably a very few number of people that are actual Jewish people, aren't they?
Well, in ancient times there was no intermarriage. Jews would not intermarry. In fact, a non-Jew was not allowed to enter the property or the home of a Jewish person, and vice versa.
Right.
Peter broke that rule because God had sent him a special vision that he should do it. There's the scene where Peter is in just drew a blank. It's before he goes to Caesarea. He's on a city on the coast. I'll think of it in a minute. And he's staying at the house of Simon the Tanner. And Cornelius, the centurion, a Roman guard, Gentile, who was a God-fearing Gentile, sent his servants to go and find Paul, because they'd heard about him. They come to his house, and they stand outside the gate and call out to Paul, because as Gentiles, they were not allowed to go through the gate or enter the property. And Peter, had just had a vision. He'd been up on the Mirador, and he'd had a vision of this sheet coming down from heaven containing all manner of animals, including unclean animals. And the voice of God said, Peter, take and eat. And Peter said, absolutely not. I've not eaten anything unclean my whole life. And God said, Peter, do not call anything unclean that I have told you is clean. And he had that vision several times. Immediately after that vision, these Gentile servants of Cornelius come to the gate, and they're calling out to him because they can't come in. Peter comes out and says, what is it? Well, we are servants of Cornelius. He has heard of you, and he sent us to find you. He wants to hear more about that. And what does Peter do? He says, come in. No Jew would have done that. And if a Gentile had invited the Jew in, no Jew would have gone in. Right there, because of the vision he had, Peter broke down that barrier. Prior to that time, not only would they not intermarry, they wouldn't even go toward, you know, in each other's yards. So there was not that issue then of intermarriage.
So the Ebuchadnezzar and all of that, those wars were later?
Who? I didn't hear the first
the
name.
Babylonians and, you know, I can't remember.
Well, the Babylonians and Nebuchadnezzar, yeah.
And that war of Israel, was that later then?
Well, no, that was before. But
were they not dispersed and inter...
When the northern kingdom of Israel was conquered by Assyria in 722 BC, yes, they were spread out and they were forced to intermarry, not because they chose to.
Right.
When the southern kingdom was defeated by Babylon in 586, actually the conquering happened over several years, but 586 is the year they destroyed the city of Jerusalem and the temple, and they took people off into captivity, they allowed them to live together. They allowed them to practice their own religion. So that about 70 years later, when the Persians had conquered Babylonia, and King Cyrus the Great, I'm going to get into that, King Cyrus the Great said, you can go back home, Jews, because he had a different approach to how to manage conquered people. They were all still one unit. It's like they as a people had moved over here, and then Cyrus said, you can go back, but they had not intermarried.
But the ones who had intermarried, that's why they're called the Lost Tribes.
That's why they're called the Lost Tribes, is because they were watered down. And an interesting thing, the organization I'm working with now, Jewish Voice, a lot of the ministry they do is with people groups in remote parts of the world. There are several tribes in Ethiopia, one, the Ibu tribe in Nigeria, the Lemba tribe in Zimbabwe, the Benai Menesh in India. All of them have claimed for, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years that they were Jewish. Their language is different than the other local languages. They follow, even though it's sometimes a weird interpretation of, they follow the Torah, the Jewish law. They have Jewish names. And sociologists have always said, well, you know, yeah, they picked this up somewhere, but they're not really Jewish. They're not biologically Jewish. Well, we now have DNA analysis, and we're proving that they really are Jewish, that these appear to be the descendants of the lost tribes of Israel. And like the Benai Menesh in India claim to be the descendants of Manasseh. And there are groups like the Lemba in Zimbabwe, they are able to identify that they are Kohenites, meaning they are descendants of the Levite tribe. The name Cohen, the Jewish name Cohen, anybody named Cohen is a descendant from Levites. And for the most part, those tribes have been kind of long. We can't identify that anymore. But there are some that we can identify genetically. And so more and more, the Beit Abraham and others in Ethiopia, they now have proven that they are. Now, they've been mixed with other people, too. I mean, the darker skin and the whole thing. But they do have clearly genetic markers that show that they are descended from Jewish people. So we actually are finding the lost tribes of Israel now. And the weird thing, I mentioned this in one of the Bible studies, the Ibu tribe in Nigeria, if they prove to be Jewish, they haven't done the genetic testing then, but they got all the other characteristics, you know, the language and names and scripture and everything else. If they do prove to be Jewish, there are 40 million Ibu. There's only 14 million Jews recognized in the world today. So we all of a sudden would have quadrupled the number of Jewish people that exist in the world. All of a sudden, the Aliyah, the right of return to Israel for anybody who's Jewish, all of a sudden that's going to have to be reconsidered because they couldn't take four times as many people there. So there are huge things about this, and they have not yet added. It's, you know, it costs like $200 to do a genetic test for this kind of thing, and so it's not like they can just go test everybody. But the more they're doing it, the more they're finding out that there really are descendants from the lost tribes of Israel out there. Okay?
So, my question is, as we come towards the end times, both the Revelations and the Chosen People, is there not a part of 144,000 or something along those lines that will now reach out to the world or the cultures?
Well, I would recommend, I would refer you to Romans 9-11, because there Paul says all of Israel will be saved. Now, he also says, and we have to add this part, that not all those who claim to be part of Israel are, that some have been broken off because of what I interpret that as meaning is those who have no faith. Almost 90% of Jewish people around the world today are completely secular.
Right.
They don't follow it as a religion. They are biologically Jewish, but they don't follow the Jewish faith. So I think that may be the broken off limbs. But those who do pursue the Jewish faith, the indication in, by Paul in Romans is that they will come to faith, which means they will turn to the Messiah. And that's why the organizations I've worked with, the Messianic Jewish organizations, their focus is on Jewish people because they believe that they are fulfilling God's desire for those people to hear about and eventually turn to the Messiah. And they're also doing humanitarian work. Like, because these tribes in Ethiopia and Zimbabwe and elsewhere, they not only are remote, but they frequently are persecuted. Their language is different, their customs are different, their religion is different, and so they're persecuted both by Muslims and by Christians in those countries. And they have a very hard life, and so they're providing humanitarian services too. Okay, I'm getting off into
it. Thank you.
Sure. All right, I want to talk a little bit about the historical setting and context, and this is, I'm going to have to rip through this pretty quick. To understand the New Testament, we really have to know something about the historical and cultural context. Bless you. We have to understand what environment created the situation we find as we study the New Testament. For instance, why did Jesus speak Aramaic? We know he did because Talitha Kume, you know, a rise little girl, is Aramaic. Aramaic is a Semitic language, like Hebrew, like Arabic, Nabataean, some others. Why, and I've already told you this, why is the New Testament written in Greek? Because Alexander had made Greek the lingua franca, the common language. What were the Pharisees and Sadducees, and why didn't they like each other? What was that all about? How and why did Jewish synagogues come to be? Why was there animosity between Jews and Samaritans? Most people, they read the story of the Good Samaritan, and they completely miss the point because they don't know what a Samaritan was. Or they hear, they read the story about Jesus traveling through Samaria between Galilee and Judea, and that he stops in the town of Samaria, and he talks to a woman at the well, and a Samaritan woman, and why is she so shocked that he's talking to her? You know, we have to, in order to be able to understand those stories, you have to know something about the background. So I'm going to give you, in 20 minutes, the whole history of the ancient peoples and everybody associated with it. In about 2090, between 2000 and 2090, and that's the C means circa, that means about, or as best we know. Abram, before he was called Abraham, Abram means exalted father. His name later was changed to Abraham, which means father of many, because God promised he would have many people as descendants. He was called by God and becomes the father to the Hebrew people. That's the first big, you know, historical event, is the call. And then there are some other things that happened with, you know, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. Joseph, who is sold into slavery by his brothers, ends up in Egypt. They all come down there to buy grain because they have grain in Egypt and everybody else is having a famine. And then we get to the next big major historical event. Somewhere between 445 and 405, we have the Exodus. Exodus means exit. Moses is called by God from a self-imposed exile, where he's herding his father-in-law's sheep, to go back to Egypt, to the Israelites, and to free them. He leads them, after confrontations with Pharaoh, he leads them out of captivity in Egypt. He has given the law, that is and the law is more than just 10 commandments. The 10 commandments, the big 10, are there, of course, but there are actually 613 commandments in the Old Testament. They are called the mitzvot in Hebrew, 613 mitzvot. And those are given. They spend 40 years wandering around in the desert because Moses was a man who wouldn't stop and ask for directions, they often say, as punishment for the fact they didn't have faith that God will allow them to take the land. Only Joshua and Caleb believed, and they're the only adult males besides Moses who survived the desert. All other male Israelites who did not have faith in God died in that 40 years. It took 40 years for them all to die off. That's why it was 40 years. Then the entry into the Promised Land under Joshua, after Moses dies, he's allowed to go up on the mountain and see the Promised Land in the distance, but he's not allowed to enter. Joshua leads them in. We then come down to the next big point, which is the United Monarchy, which started about 1050 BC. It is first Saul. God told him, you don't need a king because you got me. They said, no, all the other nations have kings. We want a king. And so he finally agreed to give him a king, and they got Saul, who turned out not to be that good. And then David and Solomon. That was the United Monarchy. And under David and Solomon is the only time in the history of the Jewish people that they really had any political significance. People, especially under Solomon, were coming from afar to visit them. The Queen of Sheba, who Caroline had been in Oman. In Oman, they claim she came from Oman. In Ethiopia, they claim she came from Ethiopia. I tend toward Ethiopia, which is one of the reasons why there are Ethiopian Jews that have been Jews long before, you know, even the Lost Tribes might have gotten there, because it's believed she took two things back to Sheba. The Queen of Sheba took two things back with her. One is she took back the Jewish faith, and secondly, she took back Solomon's son, Menelik, because they got very friendly when Sheba was visiting in Jerusalem. And then, in 931, after the death of Solomon, the kingdom is divided. God had promised David that Solomon, his son, would always sit on the throne of Israel. That he would not remove him no matter what he did. Well, Solomon married a bunch of women, and they were foreign women, which he wasn't supposed to do. He also collected a bunch of horses, which he wasn't supposed to do, because horse meant war. And these women, he allowed them to worship their foreign gods, and even encouraged it, even the ones that did child sacrifice and some other horrendous things. Solomon actually set up places in the Valley of Kidron where they could sacrifice children to foreign gods. As punishment for that, God kept his word and didn't remove Solomon, but when Solomon died, the kingdom gets split in two. Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, controls the southern part of the kingdom, and Jeroboam takes over the northern part of the kingdom, and it's split. The northern kingdom is called Israel, very confusing. Come up with a new name, guys. So, the United Kingdom of Israel, the Northern Kingdom, when they split, was called Israel. The Southern Kingdom was called Judah. The Northern Kingdom never did have any decent kings. They messed up from the start because they couldn't get to Jerusalem to worship, so they made up their own ways of worship. They started worshiping golden calves. That's why we end up with eventually a Samaritan Pentateuch that adds another commandment that says you don't have to go to Jerusalem to worship. You can worship on Mount Gerizim. Okay? But the kings were so bad, like Ahab and Jezebel. You know, she's a real Jezebel, right? Not good. So they had terrible kings. And eventually, after many prophets went and warned them over and over again, and they refused to get it right, in 722, God sends the Assyrians, one of the meanest bunch ever, to destroy the northern kingdom of Israel. They carried off the people into, spread them out in exile, brought other peoples in from conquered territories, forced them to intermarry. At that time, the northern kingdom of Israel had 10 tribes in it. The southern kingdom had the other two, Benjamin and Judah, Judah being by far the largest, so the southern kingdom was called the kingdom of Judah. And that's from Judah is where we get Jews, because after Assyria destroyed the northern kingdom, we didn't have those people anymore, so Judah, Judean, Jew, became the designation for anybody who was a follower of the Hebrew faith. We then tell you a little bit about that. The Assyrian, Neo-Assyrian Empire. Assyria is one of the major powers of the ancient Middle East. They actually had two periods of ascendancy. The time when they destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel was during their second ascendancy, which is called the Neo or New Assyrian Empire. And in 722, they destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel. And after they destroyed the northern kingdom of Israel, they marched south, got on the freeway, went south to Jerusalem, and besieged the city of Jerusalem, which was the capital city of the kingdom of Judea. Well, that was the time when Isaiah was the prophet, and Hezekiah was the king. Again, the Assyrians, you didn't mess around with them. But they're outside the walls of Jerusalem, wanting to get in, and Hezekiah is inclined to try to give in, even though he was a good king. He worshipped God. Isaiah said, don't do it. Hold out. Do not give in. Well, after a period of them being outside the walls, God sent apparently a plague. And the way the King James used to say it is kind of funny. It, in effect, says, and the next morning, they went to bed. The next morning, the Assyrians woke up to find themselves dead. What happened is, apparently, a plague was sent. A significant number of the Assyrian army died. And so Sennacherib, who was the king at that time, he leaves. He gives up, goes home. Short time after that, two of his sons assassinate him. And the first example of political spin in history is in the Chronicles of Sennacherib. He says, I defeated this kingdom and this kingdom and this kingdom and this kingdom. And the king of Jerusalem, I penned up in his city like a caged bird. Basically, I couldn't defeat him. All I could say is I caged him up. He leaves, the southern kingdom survives for quite a bit longer. In 612, Assyria, who had been the dominant force, they were conquered by the Babylonians. Assyria is sort of from where we know of as Iran. It was kind of Persia. Babylon is Iraq. Both of these are kind of their Middle Eastern empires. So in 612, Assyria is conquered by the Babylonians. This is the Neo-Babylonian Empire from 626 to about 539 BC. Again, like the Assyrians, they had two ascendancies. The first one was under the king Hammurabi, who wrote the first legal code in history, the Code of Hammurabi. And then the Neo-Assyrians, or the Neo-Babylonians, come along. And in 599, the Babylonians defeat Judah, the southern kingdom of Judah, but don't destroy it then. They deport part of the people, including the prophet Ezekiel. Ezekiel was deported into Babylon. Then in 586, Babylonians destroy Jerusalem. They burn the temple. The prophet Jeremiah records this in the book of Jeremiah, in the book of Lamentations, and he literally witnesses the Shekinah glory of God rising up away from the temple of God. The temple which was considered the throne of God on earth. And God departs, again in punishment for the evils done by the southern kingdom. They weren't as bad as the northern kingdom, but they still had denied God over and over again. And this is the second deportation. In there, we have Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, or as Carolyn's learned growing up, Daniel, Shekabed, Mekabed, and Abednego. That's how they learned it as a little kid. So that's why you get the book of Daniel. Daniel is in Babylon, and you get Nebuchadnezzar, who is the king that was king during the destruction and the deportation. You get the period from 586 to 538 where the people who were taken out of the southern kingdom of Judah and the city of Jerusalem when it was destroyed, taken over and forced to live in Babylon. You know, in Ezekiel he talks about, by the rivers of Babylon we wept. So they're in exile, but that exile only lasts about 50 or so years. And then the Persians, or 70 years, the Persians, the Persian kingdom, defeats the Babylonians. But this Babylonian exile was very critical to understanding the situation of the Jews and what existed later. There were a number of questions, problems that the Babylonian exile presented to the Jews. They were left to wonder, does our God Yahweh, is he not really as powerful as the Babylonian gods? Back then they had a very simple idea. If your God was more powerful, then you won. Well, since the kingdom of Judah had been defeated by the Babylonians, were the Babylonian gods more powerful than Yahweh? They had to decide. Does it mean that God no longer loves the Jewish people? Or that he no longer accepts them as his chosen people? Does it mean, how are the Jews supposed to continue in their religion when the things that they thought marked them as the people of God are gone? No more promised land. They are in captivity in another place. No temple to worship in. The temple had been destroyed. And their religious worship was entirely centered around the temple. People were supposed to come there for the Jewish festivals. Animal sacrifice, high priests, and all of that. How do they worship without a temple? What are we going to do? Are they going to be assimilated into a foreign culture the same way it's happened to the northern kingdom of Israel? And completely deluded and to become lost? Well, there's several things that happened in terms of changes because of the Babylonian exile. One, the Jewish people began to use Aramaic or Chaldean language as their common everyday tongue. It was their street language, so to speak. Now, you remember that Abraham, when he was Abram, he was called Abram from Ur of the Chaldees. The Chaldees is the area in Mesopotamia. The word Mesopotamia literally means the land between the rivers, the Tigris and Euphrates River. That was the Chaldean area. That's where Babylon was. That's modern-day Iraq. And the Chaldees, that region, the language spoken there was called Chaldean. It's what we call Aramaic. And because the Jews were in exile there for two generations, they started talking that way. If you had small kids, or if your kids were, you were an American or a Canadian, and you moved to Mexico and you had kids and they grew up, what language would they speak in the streets? They'd speak the native language. They may speak English at home, but they would speak Spanish out in the streets. Same thing happened with the Jews. Two generations, they started speaking Chaldean or Aramaic. It was related to Hebrew. It was common in the Assyrian and Babylonian empires, and the Jews just adopted it because they were in exile in that land for a while. That's why Jesus and everybody else spoke three languages. They spoke Hebrew because that was the Jewish language and what the scriptures were written in. They spoke Greek because of the influence of Alexander the Great and the Macedonian conquest. And they spoke Aramaic because of the Babylonian exile. All right? And so when you hear these, like Talitha Kum, you know, rise up, little girl, Jesus says, he's speaking Aramaic, the common language of the day. It's also true that the Israelites finally acknowledged that it wasn't that God wasn't as powerful, but rather that God had caused their fall because of lack of faithfulness. There therefore was a renewed interest in praying, in studying scripture, other pious studies, and also in community life. Their concern was, we need to get back to God because of us allowing ourselves to be pulled away from God is what caused this problem, and we need to make sure that we don't get assimilated. We need to really focus on community life. All of those things were satisfied by the creation of a synagogue system. They didn't have the temple anymore, so they created synagogues. Synagogues included schools, places of prayer, of worship. Now, they could not sacrifice animals. There were certain things that were only allowed to be done in the temple that they never tried to reproduce in synagogues. There has not, since the Babylonian exile, there has never been a full return to the sacrificial system. There was during the time of Jesus somewhat, but it's always been a little shaky because the temple was never quite restored until Herod came along, and that didn't last very long. AD 70, the Romans destroyed again. So all of these changes occurred because of the Babylonian exile. You then get the Persians coming along, and Darius the Great, the king of Persia, and we read about this in Daniel. In fact, there's the story that it says his son, but that's a general statement. It's probably his grandson, Belteshazzar, who is the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar, is the king at that point. And he's having a great party with his friends, and he decides to show off how powerful he is. He sends somebody to get the sacred implements that were taken out of the temple at Jerusalem and bring them in, and we're going to use them to party with. So they took what had been the sacred Jewish implements, and they're using them to put party food on and drink wine out of and stuff. And he sees the finger of God appears and writes tekel tekel metal parson on the wall. And nobody can understand what that means. Well, they've heard that this guy Daniel is Jewish, that he is a great interpreter of dreams and things like that, so they call him in. And Daniel says, what that means is, and they say, we'll give you half the kingdom, we'll give you all the stuff you can interpret. He said, I don't want anything from you, but I will tell you what it says. It says, you have been weighed and found wanting, and your kingdom is required of you. That night, according to Scripture, Darius the Great and the Persian army conquered Babylon. Okay? That's the story. So Darius comes in, defeats them. King Cyrus comes along. He says, very different approach. Whereas the Assyrians and the Babylonians basically would take people off into captivity, the Assyrians would actually destroy their sense of unity, and so they wouldn't rebel. But the Persians believed the best way to keep people in line was to be nice to them. And so let them practice their own religion, let them have their own sort of government system, again, like the Romans, as long as they pay their taxes and don't cause a problem. And he said, you can go back home if you want, Jews. And so in the 450s, Ezra, and then here we get into the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, which in the Hebrew Bible is one book. Ezra leads some returnees back, and he begins to teach and encourage Zerubbabel and Joshua go back first. Joshua's high priest, and then later Ezra goes back to teach them Torah. So they start rebuilding the temple, they start teaching Torah, and then the report comes back in the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is serving the king, and his brother and some others come back and say, he says, how's it going in Jerusalem? And they go, well, it's pretty rough, because we're trying to build the temple, but there's no walls around the city, and so anybody and everybody sort of breaks in and steals our stuff, and it's kind of rough. So Nehemiah feels called to go back and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, whereas the Zerubbabel, Joshua, Ezra are more concerned with the temple itself and teaching the Torah. Nehemiah goes back and rebuilds the walls. And then in 430 BC, we get Malachi, the last Old Testament prophet. I'm going to rip through this real quick because we're running out of time. I mentioned already that in 356, Alexander the Great is born in Macedonia to King Philip II, which I always say is the least appreciated historical figure of anywhere, of all time. Philip had conquered all of Greece and the whole region. Philip invented a completely new way to do warfare. It used to, before Philip, the armies would line up in straight line, shoulder to shoulder, and draw their swords and spears and scream really loud and rush at each other and hope they killed more of the other guys than they did you. Philip created the phalanx, which became later on used by the Romans and others. It was 16 men square, and they used he invented a long spear so that the guys four or five rows back could also extend their spears in front of the front rows, and they would attack in formation. He also invented heavy cavalry, the idea of horses that could be used not just to be able to travel around and see what the other army is doing, but to actually attack from horseback. Some people say that there's a story that he may have been the one who invented the stirrup. Imagine trying to go into battle on horseback without stirrups. And so he completely revolutionized warfare. And he had a plan. The Greeks and the Persians had always hated each other. I won't get into all that history. It had to do with the golden age of Greece and Pericles and all that. But Philip had a plan to use his new military techniques and his army to defeat the whole Persian Empire, which was the huge empire at that time. In 336, Philip is assassinated, probably by his ex-wife, Olympia, the mother of Alexander, because he had dumped his old wife and married a younger model, and who had a daughter, and there was some concern by Alexander and his mother Olympia that the daughter and her mother were going to try to take over. So Philip dies, is assassinated by his personal guards. They think that Olympia and Alexander may have been behind it. And Olympia takes control again and immediately has the rival wife and her daughter burned alive. So they had a very direct approach back then, how to deal with things. And then in 334, Alexander, who had served as a commander, even as a very young man, like by age 18, he was leading troops. By age 20, he was a major commander in his father's military. In 334, he launches the Persian campaign that had been planned by his father. And in between 334 and 323, Alexander's armies conquer virtually the whole known world. And then on the way home, Alexander dies at age 32 or 33, right in there. This is Alexander's route from Macedonia, which is part of Greece, into Asia Minor, and then down. He goes down through the Middle East into Egypt, where he's welcomed as a conqueror and a god. And then over, he conquers places nobody's ever been able to conquer. Afghanistan, ask the British, ask the Russians, ask us. You don't conquer Afghanistan, but Alexander did. All the way to India. And he wanted to go on to the ocean, to the great waters after India. Never lost a battle. And after almost 10 years of this, his troops finally said, Al, we want to go home, you know, and he was afraid there'd be a rebellion if he didn't. So he finally decided to turn back. I don't think I've got yet. And when he turned back, he got as far as Babylon, which he had decided he was going to make his home base, and he dies there of unknown causes. We don't know if it's food poisoning or, you know, an illness or whatever it was. He never lost a battle. When he first crossed over into Asia Minor and had this first battle, because it was all controlled by Persia, the first battle, his 30,000-man army defeated an army of 100,000. Later on, Darius, who was the king of Persia at that point, he thought, okay, I'll show him. So he put together a 200,000-man army. By that point, Alexander, because he got recruits as he defeated places, and people said, hey, you're a winner, I want to be on your side, he had an army of 38,000. So his 38,000 defeated 200,000 soldiers on the other side. There are these great stories, like Darius, the king, he said, look, we don't have to fight. I will give you all of Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. I will pay you tribute. I'll make you rich beyond your imagination. Just go home. And Alexander said no. In fact, what he said was, and next time you want to communicate with me, don't dare speak to me like an equal. You know, he's talking to the king of the largest empire that existed to that point. One of the generals of Alexander, Parmenion, who was a great general and one of the closest friends, Parmenion said to Alexander, after that offer was made to take Asia Minor and a lot of wealth, Parmenion said, you know, if I had been Alexander, I think I would have taken that deal. And Alexander looked at him and said, well, if I had been Parmenion, I would have too. He believed he was divinely intended to conquer. He gets down near Israel to Phoenicia, for instance, and the city of Tyre. There was a city on the mainland, but then a kilometer out is an island, and that's where they had their fortress. That was where their real power was. Well, and he couldn't get to them. In fact, he didn't have any ships at that point, Alexander. He destroys the city of Tyre that's on the mainland, takes all of the rubble from the buildings and stuff, and builds a causeway that's 300 yards wide and a kilometer long to get out to the fortress. And then, as he's doing this, he's thinking, you know, I probably do need a navy too. So he went and got one. He basically, because they conquered some of the Persian ports, all of the boats that came into those ports, he just took them over. And so when he came back, he brought the boats. They defeated the city of Tyre, which had never been defeated and was thought to be completely impregnable. As he came down into Israel, the priests came out with the books. And it talks about the fact that a conqueror from the west will come and defeat the Persian Empire in Daniel. And he says, that's me. He says, I like that book, and I like you guys. I'm going to leave you alone. And I said, fine with us. So he didn't bother them. Went down to Egypt, was named a god, took over Egypt, traveled on story after story after story. You know, in India, he discovered what a war elephant was, and he still won those battles. I'm going to stop. Next time, I'm going to take about 10 more minutes and pick up the Ptolemaic period, the Seleucid period. As we approach December this year, in addition to our Christmas, of course, the Jews will be celebrating Hanukkah. And when we get into the story of after Alexander, you know, Alexander died in Babylon, and he didn't have any heirs. And so we end up, all of his generals are gathered around him saying, Who's going to take over? And the story is, he said, to the strongest. He's talking to generals. This was a declaration of war. And they had a war called the War of the Diadochi, which means the War of the Successors. And they ended up dividing up the new empire that Alexander had conquered amongst several of his generals. And that is critical to understanding the history of the Middle East at that point. And we'll pick that up next week. Any questions about any of that? What? Yes, any questions? You laugh, right? I'll spend just 5 or 10 minutes on that next week before we get into the gospel stuff, because it is interesting, you know, what happened after Alexander and how it affected the Jewish people. Thank you all very much. I appreciate you being here, and I hope to see you next week. Okay. Or maybe I hope to see you tomorrow in church.
Ooh, yeah.